My name is Aparajita Acharya. I'm currently a third year law student in symbiosis. And around 2 years back, I wrote a coffee table book. I authored a coffee table book about my father's journey. It's called Our Bablu, the Hero of Dras. Dras was a sector of the Kargil War. So it was a war, it was a part of the war and where he fought. And when he came back, they said, this man is the hero of Dras. So, like, if you have heard, Vikram Batra sir was called Sher Shah of Kargil. So, people were conferred with titles. So, Daddy was the hero of Dras. So, it is titled as Our Bablu, because he went as Our Bablu, but he came back as the hero of Dras. So, I wrote this coffee table book about his journey. And that book changed my life, because I got to know so much about my father and struggles and, you know, about his struggles and his way of perceiving life. And it taught me a lot of things. He speaks of dharma, of a soldier. And the concept of dharma stuck to me. I have grown up reading the Bhagavad Gita, which is why when I'm talking, you'll find a lot of Gita references. Because I really think if we were to understand our duty, that is one of those books that if you read, you will understand that duty and responsibility is there's so much more to it. And there's so many points that ma'am and Sharath have both stated, which I will be reiterating to. Post the book, there was always a trust on Daddy's name, which was called the Major Padmapani Acharya Foundation. But I sort of added a lot of other things to the foundation and actively started conducting programs. Earlier it was pure small charity work that used to happen, and then we started conducting seminars and talks and debates, and we used to go to schools and, you know, ask children to think of inspiration. So today's theme is very beautiful: youth leadership responsibility, which can also be called or termed as youth participation. But youth participation in what? In nation building. I'm going to be talking today about how the youth can participate in nation building. But what is nation building? There are a lot of definitions, but I would like to put it in a very simple way. It is a multi-dimensional concept. So it involves active participation of citizens from various walks of life. It involves tapping into the potential of, you know, its human resource, the nation's human resource, reducing the social and economic disparity that exists in the society, and creating an empowering environment. So, the citizens of a country are its human resource. When you empower people, when you channelize them, you reduce the disparity, the unequal treatment between people. You know, we say life is not fair. But how do we try to bridge that unfairness? So, all these elements are involved in nation building. But why the youth? Why should the youth be so involved in nation building? So, the United Nations Population Fund conducted a very interesting survey. So, 1.8 billion people globally age between 15 and 24. Most of these youth come from developing countries. 173 million young people belong to these low-income countries, and they can't read a sentence. They can't read a sentence. And out of these, 73 million unemployed. These are pure statistics when we look at it. But when we look deeper, we realize there are three pillars on which any society can exist. At least, through the books I have read, I think that these are ideally the three pillars. First is education. And when I talk of education, I'm not just talking of languages, science, or whatever subject you prefer. I'm talking of also the life learning, the moral values. Because as Sharath has said, that, you know, today our values are for sale. We are not concrete when it comes to our most basic values. So all that is part of education. The second is employment. You give education to people. Today, everybody, irrespective of which income group, more or less everybody has a degree. Whether that degree is an outcome of fruitful studies or whether it is from a good institution, that is a different question. But education is something today more or less a lot of people have. The kind of education offered, I'm saying. But the next problem that comes is employment. So this education, they are educated people, but how effectively are we using that education? How many people actually use the knowledge they gather over the years? How do they implement it? And third, empowerment. So you can employ people, you can employ educated people, but do they feel empowered? What difference do their actions make? So these are three things. If we educate, employ and empower people, we can really make this nation progress. But as the youth, how can we employ people? So this is a very interesting idea that I have that I would like to share with you. So society has needs and it has resources. Now, I want all of us to apply this to individual skill set. Shara sir also spoke about this. So, say a society has some needs, there are two ways of approaching it. There are people who want to fulfill those needs but don't have the resources. There are people who have the resources but they have no intention of fulfilling that need. Say there are people who are sick. You have doctors who can treat them. There are doctors who have the knowledge but don't really want to get into pro bono work and treat people. And there are people on the other hand, they want to help people but they don't have the knowledge of medicine to help them. So how do we go about it? There are two ways of doing this. The society can either acquire the already available resources, as in, say, as he said, if you are good at a single subject, you helping another person, that is using your knowledge to help another person. Using an existing resource, it's faster, it's better. And you know, it just makes more sense. While acquiring new knowledge, what pre-existing knowledge you have, how do you use it to help another person? So if we come together, use whatever little things we are good at, whatever we think we can help, you know, that can bring us all together. How do we bridge this gap? That is very important. Individually, what we might do might be multiplied through our networking, through our expansion. Access plays a very important part. Now all of you are part of this organization. You meet a lot of people, you do community service together. So, say there are 10 people who decide, okay, each of us are good at one subject, you go to a government school and you take classes for them one day. What you could have done alone as a person, as a group, that is amplified. But that does not mean you wait for a group. You work on your own until you can possibly come together. But together, the youth can create an impact. We have energy, we have the time, and when we are young, we are allowed to make a certain mistakes. And mistakes, but when I say mistakes, I mean when we try to do things and are unsuccessful, we still have chances. We are still young, we are still learning. So we are at probably the age at which we are at our maximum potential. My mother said one thing to me. She said, when you're young, when she looks at me, she says, I don't want you to sleep in the afternoon. You're too young for it. You're too young to sleep in the afternoon. So work as much as you can, so that when you actually go to sleep, you barely get dreams. We normally never get dreams when we're very tired. She said, I want you to hit the bed only when you're so tired that you don't get dreams. You should be, and when you're awake, you should be at working as much as you can. So there are three ways of bridging this gap that I told you. But the gap between whom? The gap between us as people and our country. So in Gita, there's this beautiful line which says, you know that belief makes a man. What you believe, you become. You know, there are a lot of terms people use, liberals, nationalists. So if your thoughts are liberal, you are a liberal. If you... your thoughts are very nationalistic, you become a national. But what I mean to say is, when I'm saying you are what your belief is, if you truly believe in things, they will subconsciously become your actions. Say you believe in cleanliness, you will keep clean. So you become a clean person. I'm talking of hygiene. So our thoughts really influence what we become as people. And as ma'am spoke about the intent and outcome, there's a line in Gita that says that also, that you know, your actions should be based on intent, not outcome. That matters more. What is your purpose? My father in his letters multiple times wrote that everybody has a purpose in life. Figure out that purpose. you might think that by teaching one student, kaun sa desh ka bhala ho jayega? Like, it won't make a sudden change in a day. But the fact that you're trying to help someone which is a pure thought, that itself is a start. The outcome of the nation itself progressing is going to happen only when a lot of people come together and think about the same thing without depending on each other. Yes, we coexist, but that does not mean that you wait for the other person to start thinking when you do. And there are three things that I think are very important to keep in mind. The correct attitude. When I talk of this gap, I've seen it in my elder generation. When I look at my parents or my grandfather for that matter, he couldn't start his day without reading the newspaper. All of you know, mostly our parents, they cannot start their day without reading the newspaper. My grandfather used to get irritated. He couldn't start his day. He used to wait for the paper to come. And every day they read the paper because they find it very important to know what's going around them, what's going around in the country, what's going around in the world. I do not find that in today's generation. We think it's a choice to know what is going around us. It's very important to focus on career. I agree. But isn't it also important to know what is happening around the world? Whether you can help people or not. It's a very basic thing. It's good to focus on personal goals. But you should realize that you'll reach a full circle, or you will be a true human with our minds which are more blessed than the others, because we can perceive things that others can't. Other beings, they're too simple. We are made to manage a lot. We are made to grow and to handle situations. So it's much more than personal. It's much more than personal goals. It's okay if you're happy today, but what about tomorrow? Tomorrow when you are low, you expect somebody to be there to help you. But then you should also be in a state to go out and help people. Second is actions and integrity. We say a lot of things, but our actions and our integrity reflect it. So what I'm trying to tell you is, when you believe in something, have the integrity. So if you think corruption is wrong, at no point should a bribe, don't think that just one time, just 10 rupees. No. If you think bribing is wrong, then stick to it. Bureaucracy will stop only if you have the integrity. Western culture is wonderful for people to think that it's more cooler, but it's not necessarily. For a lot of time, people thought that the American thinking was the way ahead. They were the next generation. They were the future. Whatever America was doing was something countries would eventually do. And that was the right way of living. A lot of people looked up to their lifestyle. But when you look today, their system is failing in so many ways. They themselves complain that family is no more an institution for them. Because they do not have the concept of family and togetherness anymore. They don't talk of when they are in trouble, they can't even call up their parents sometimes. They don't stay with them. And at one point of time, people thought these were very archaic. People looked at our culture as archaic. Healthy doodh, which is something our mothers ask us to have every day, Starbucks sells as turmeric latte for 200 rupees and people are buying the same thing. Was thought to be archaic. Yoga is now suddenly all around the world. US is marketing yoga. It was there in our country for ages. So the integrity and our actions. We have to learn to embrace our culture. There is nothing wrong in embracing our culture because it's more rich than anything. And with time, some practices stop, some practices grow. But because of those few practices, that doesn't mean you shun the entire culture. Because our culture is too rich. And we are a product of it. Subconsciously, the things we believe in are because of the traditions that have been handed down to us. And finally, this is one point that I would like to say. How can we as the youth facilitate in nation building is have the courage to pursue and protect. I'm not telling you protect the country. I'm just telling you start small. If you really want to do something, have the courage to try it out. Try it out. And the second, if you feel strongly for something, protect that opinion. Don't feel shy to express it. If you find somebody doing something wrong, say it. There's so many times you find people smoking in public places, but we just keep quiet. We just say it in our hearts that smoking is bad. why can't you just walk up to that person, be respectful and say, sir, you're not, this is a public space, you're not supposed to be smoking here. If you feel for something strongly, you can start by expressing that opinion. Express it respectfully, but express it nonetheless. You know, complete knowledge. We should know the sources we are depending on our information from. Another thing, when I spoke of intent, was that, you know, work is about intent. Sometimes it's not about ethics. A lot of people ask me, you know, when I say that soldiers are like saints because they are fighting for peace. They say that, how can you kill for peace? How is war a solution to peace? But life isn't always as simple as that, right? I mean, sometimes you have to do what it takes to stop the person who's creating that harm. So sometimes it's about the intent. When a soldier is fighting, his intent is to protect his people, his country. So the ethics involved don't matter. They don't really matter over there. So sometimes it's just about your intent. And if you really intend to do well, then eventually in the course of time, you'll understand that, you know, some things just have to happen. When I'm talking of dharma, we all have that dharma. Like, I believe service to my country is not a choice. It's my responsibility. Even if I cannot join the army by wearing the uniform, I try to do my bit for the country. You can do your bit for the country, even if you're not in the army, doctor, teacher, whatever you become, just try. Try to give those values you stand for. And the next time we criticize somebody, you know, we should look into it a little deeper. I have personally come to believe, we as the youth know we are very raged. We look at politicians of a certain party and say, this action of theirs is wrong because this is their motive. Definitely. We buy the product based on who the seller is. If we don't like the person, even if they're selling something good, we'll never like the product. We'll never like their idea. I really think that, you know, as he said, our views should, we should be open to seeing new things. We should be open to thinking of a possibility of something good. And we shouldn't have a straitjacket view of what is right or wrong. We should be willing to try. And I really think the best way of doing that is going out, you know, listening to stories, telling people and working, really working towards what we do. Every morning I start by doing a very simple thing. I freshen up, I pray to God, I look at my father's photo. But every day I do something wrong, I don't look at my father's photo because I don't have the guts to. Every time I've made a mistake in life, I have not been able to look at my father's photograph. Because somewhere I feel that, you know, he would not approve of this. He would not approve of me being such a lazy, irresponsible person. So I really think you should find out that one thing that motivates you and keep that as your fear factor. Find a role model and just think that you don't want to disappoint that role model in you. Because having role models really helps you. It'll help you. It'll guide you through any situation. I said this the last time I came here. I'm busy with my projects. Sometimes I feel, okay, I'll call my mother later. And then I remember my father would write letters from the war zone. They probably got 1 hour out of 3 days some rest. So I am nobody to say that I don't have 5 minutes to call my mother. So, you know, we all make a lot of excuses for convenience. We have to stop thinking of convenience. So I really think that we can be so much more productive through our thoughts, through our actions, and if we are willing to reach out. So if all of you are really interested in reaching out and, you know, doing something for the society, just come together and do it. And as I attempt to do so, I would love if any of you would get in touch with me. Swamiji, that day after the talk, a lot of people messaged me saying you had come over here that day and, you know, it was really nice meeting you. And that felt so good because people were trying to connect. We can connect together, we can work and we can spread a message. And that's all I will say, that we all have a responsibility subconsciously. Find your purpose in life. I'm also figuring out mine. But as long as we think to do some good and we work towards it, I think that will be the biggest motivator for us. Thank you so much.